This is one of those weeks where preaching the lectionary is, which is what I do most Sundays, and it's usually great. It helps me not just focus on one particular passage that I love and know and I keep doing it, but instead it forces me to do my homework and my research. And if you don't know what the lectionary is, it's a series of four readings at least, sometimes five readings, every Sunday. Actually, there's a daily lectionary as well, but every Sunday has its own set of readings, an Old Testament reading, a psalm, at least one, usually two sometimes, a third reading from the epistles, and then a fourth one from the gospel. And most of the time in Protestant churches, we're preaching from the gospel. But there are three other passages there for a reason. And we try at least to cover one of the Psalms each week. But it's rare that we actually get to one of the Old Testament readings. And as I looked at the readings this week, I'd love to tell you that out of God's movement in my life, I moved to this reading. I'd love to tell you that, but I'd be lying. What moved me to this reading was the gospel reading this week is just one of those that blows my mind. I can't get my head around it. Well, if I can't get my head around it, I can't preach it. And so I decided, let me see what the Old Testament reading is for this week. And in fact, I think that was God's point this week for me, was to don't get all wrapped up in a New Testament, in a gospel reading, but instead pick up one of the Old Testament readings that can have some power. And so I picked up Isaiah 65 towards the end of the Isaiah collection, verses 17 to 25. And you will recognize some of this, I suspect, but it's a powerful piece. So I'll tell you what, let me shut up and hear the word of the Lord. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever for what I am creating, for I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered cursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them, and they shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit, and they shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat, for like the days of a tree, all the days of my people will be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants will be as well. Before they call, I will answer. And yet while they're speaking, I will hear. And the wolf and the lamb shall together feed. And the lion shall eat straw like the ox. But the serpent, well, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt nor destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. May God grant understanding to this reading of God's holy word, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's come to God in prayer. Almighty and merciful God, wow. If we could just get ourselves to that place. See, it was there at one time. We blew it. We walked away from it. We continue to walk further away from it. But it's not like it's not regainable. You have promised you'll return it and you will come and bring it all back for us. But we've got to want it. We've got to show that we want the peaceable kingdom. We've got to reach out in love and stop the hate and the selfish interest. We got to reach out and say to each other, including ourselves and maybe to ourselves the loudest, enough. Enough of the hatred, enough of the problems that we cause for each other. If you're hungry, here's something to eat. If you're really cold and you have no clothes, well, try this on. If you have no place to live, maybe we might want to stop charging exorbitant rents that no one can pay except the wealthy. And maybe we make sure, as we was done by this congregation last week, that an 80-year-old, 88-year-old isn't evicted because she speaks her mind. We need to do more of that, Lord. So help us to do that. Because I think that is the message of today's Bible passage. That's what you were saying to us so long ago and still say to us today. And I'll try to, maybe add on to that, although I don't know that adding on is the right thing. But maybe I can revisit it with the folks who are here. And maybe, just maybe, people will hear you more clearly because we spent some time together. And that's my prayer, that your people hear you clearly and your message, and not just hear you, but then go into the world and make it happen. If even a little of that happens, then I will smile for the rest of my days. That's what I'm asking you for, Lord, to give me the words and whatever else is needed to bring people to a point where they actually take your words and go into the world and make them happen. And now, Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be holy and acceptable in your sight, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. I always, when there's a secular holiday, I got to think about, okay, does it fit anywhere in Scripture? Does it have anything to do with what we're trying to do as Christians? And then I usually miss the holiday on Sunday, so I go the next week. And I did that this time. Last week was Veterans Day. And just so we're all clear on Veterans Day, Veterans Day is a day to remember all those who served their country in the armed forces. It's not military, or it's not police, it's not fire, it's the armed forces, okay? And previously to this, it was Armistice Day. It was changed in 1954 was when the name was changed, and it was put into effect on the same time as the armistice, not the end of, but the armistice of World War I, the 11th day, the 11th hour, the 11th month. So that's when we celebrate, if you ever really want to try to remember it without your calendar, that's how you remember. But there is significance. The 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, everything stopped. It was a couple more months before the treaty was signed. But I guess for me, it shows that it is possible to stop fighting without the formal announcement, without the formal paper. We just got to decide to stop doing it. It is not, by the way, for those who are in active service. We've picked up this habit, and I don't think it's a bad one, but we see people in uniform, we say thank you for your service, but that's not what Veterans Day is about. Veterans Day is about those who have served and are no longer in active service, on active duty. And it's not just for those, it's not about those who have died. For years, I confused Veterans Day with Memorial Day. And it's not. Memorial Day is for those who have died. It's set apart and specially for those who have died. Veterans Day is for all of them, those who died, those who are still alive, those who have worn a uniform at one point or another in the military, whether they're alive or dead. Veterans Day remembers them all. Memorial Day is just for those who have given their life. Veterans Day is for all who served, and particularly those who have been wounded, who have been injured, who have mental injuries, which we've found more in recent years. Veterans Day is a time to really remember them and to reach out. And there's a lot of that out there. If you think this is not something we have, you don't even need to look very far, but around the streets here in Birmingham to find folks who are mentally affected by war. And if you have ever been in war, if you are a veteran, you've ever been near combat, you get it. You understand how that can happen. So Veterans Day is really to say thank you. And the other thing to remember is veterans isn't just for all those folks who volunteered to serve, because most of them didn't. Most of your veterans did not volunteer, at least not from my age, our age. They were all, drafted, yeah. I'm looking for a different word. So many of them were drafted. Even today, while we don't have a draft, so many are kind of forced into military service because they got no place else to go. So a lot of folks aren't, much as we'd like to say folks volunteered, hasn't been so, at least not in recent years. I choose also on Veterans Day to remember another group, and that's the families. If you know a family who has had someone serve, whether they're still alive or whether they're, they've been killed in action or whatever, just kind of put your arm around them. You don't even need to say anything. Just put your arm around them. If you have served, if you have had a son or daughter serve in the military, you know what that's like. I still remember my mother screaming at me, "What are you doing?" Because I enlisted. My mother's screaming, "What are you doing?" And I can still see her standing outside the train, tears streaming down her face. And I lived. So please be with the families. It's hard on them. And particularly with wives who have 2 and 3 kids who watch their loved ones, or husbands. Now, these days, it could be a husband just as equally, who are going off to war, and they can't come home from work each day. It's hard life. And so please remember them, and where you can, reach out to them and be of help. If you know a military family who someone's on deployment, be of help if you can. Cook a meal, cut a grass, cut a lawn, do something for them, because it's hard. So, and several of you, I'm not telling several of you something you don't know. So that's all very nice, John, but what does that have to do with us as Christians? Well, I think what we're talking about with the veterans is sacrifice. They give up something, they sacrifice. And we as Christians are called to sacrifice. Like veterans, by the way, we often don't get to choose how or when we sacrifice. God calls us and we say no. I always love to talk to pastors. If you ask them about their call, they will tell you at least 2 or 3 times they said no. That's true. I mean, typically pastors, we get this call from God and we go, "What, are you kidding me? Are you nuts?" See, I think God is crazy some days, but God calls us and we go, "What is the matter with you? I can't do that." And God says, and I'm not only can I not do it, I'm not going to. And it's amazing how, within a fairly short period of time, you find yourself in the middle of ministry and go, oh, how'd that happen? See, we're called to sacrifice, but it's not just ordained pastors. It's each of you. As we become Christians, we are called to serve, to minister, to care, and to sacrifice. By the way, nobody ever tells us that until we're into it. The recruiter is very good about getting us recruited into it and engaged, and then finding out, oh yeah, by the way, we gotta serve. Sometimes, by the way, our service is costly. It's not just missionaries overseas. It's those that serve down at one of the mission centers down in Detroit. Or any of the center cities. It's those who, how many people do you know who in genuine attempt at being Christians have gotten their feelings hurt or they feel harmed or damaged? They reached out, they did what God asked them to do, but they got injured. And it hurts. So it's sacrificial no matter where you go. Now, the good news is there's some good times too that we serve and we see good things happening because of that service. We spend some time with somebody. We listen to them. We pray with them. We love them. And it's amazing to watch their transformation, but it doesn't always go that way. But you know what? Whether it goes that way or not, you served. You sacrificed. You've done your ministry. We're called as Christians to do what we can to facilitate God's work. And let me give you this piece real quick. It doesn't matter how successful you are. See, I remember, I guess the best way I can illustrate is that I remember when I had some kids growing up, I was coaching a soccer team, and the guys who ran the league didn't like me. And so I got what I called the weak and the lame on my team. I mean, they gave me everybody who couldn't play for one reason or another. I had the two biggest discipline problems in the Clawson School District. I had a young boy who, as a child, pulled a pot of boiling water over into his lap. And his legs were scarred. He didn't have range of motion. I had two kids with really bad cases of asthma, and a couple more. I had my son who was just flat out clumsy. But at any rate, you know, I did not have the greatest team, and we got out there and we play, and I can still remember initially these kids coming off this field and they had just gotten whooped, you know. And being in tears, and I looked at them, and I would say to them, why are you crying? We lost. Did you? Did you do the best you could with what you had? Yeah. Dry your eyes. Go home and have a cookie. Because that's the best anybody can ask. And as a matter of fact, you won because I suspect that there are really good players on that field who only gave it half their effort. You gave it everything you had. As a Christian, did you do today the best you could with what you had to make a difference in someone's life in the name of Christ? You'll hear those words come out of my mouth over and over and over again. Did you do the best you could today with what you had to make a positive difference in someone's life in the name of Christ? If you did, go to sleep, and you'll rest in peace. You see, that's what God really would like to see happen. We sacrifice to change things that are not what God intended, because that's what needs change. Look, let's take a second to look at how the world is today. You know, we read in the scripture about people, living people dying, children dying. People die. You know, we figured that out. But did you realize that 4.68 children die each day due to neglect? 4.68 kids every day die in the United States due to neglect. 5.4 million children die before they reach age 5, and that was back in 2013 before we had COVID and all those things. 5.4 million children die, 1 in 26. 17 deaths per 1,000 in 2020 died in their first month. And sadly, many of that is in this country, where we've got the capacity to do better. In Michigan, 6.8 kids per 1,000 die. In 2020, that meant 706 kids before their first birth. Then old people die too. We know that, right? Average age years, guys, don't be frightened, but guess what? Our average age is 76.1 years. That's average. So some are going to go before then, some after that. Ladies, you're okay. You're 81.1. you got us beat. That's okay. That's as of 2022. In Monaco, people live 89.4 years. Japan, they live 85.3 years. Oh, Central African Republic? Anybody want to take a guess? What's the average life expectancy of someone who lives in a Central African Republic? 53, 54. Yeah, that's pretty impressive when ours is 74. See, what we have is not what God intended. Scripture says, God, if you live to be 100, you're young. I don't know. I feel pretty old at 74, but or 71, rather. But at this point, God is saying, look, there's so much more to be had if we will live life as God intended us to live it. What we have now is people don't build for themselves. They build for others. And they can't afford to rent it. They farm for other people because not everybody has the capacity to farm. We see in this scripture where the animals don't kill, except that I didn't realize this. Do you realize mosquitoes kill about a million people every year? Mosquitoes. Humans. We're animals too. We kill about 475,000 every year. Snakes, 50,000. I'm scared to death of snakes. It looks like I should be more afraid of you all than snakes. The point is, that is not what God intended initially. It's not what God put us here for. And so I think we need to begin to look at, and we're not going to change it tomorrow. And by the way, we're not going to change it at all. Well, maybe we will, but we need God's help. God will change it, but we got to show an effort and a willingness to change. So how do we change things? Well, I think we sacrifice. We sacrifice our time. We put time in to help other people. Simple things like if you're capable, Habitat for Humanity, that's building things for other people. They won't let me anywhere near a hammer because I'm dangerous, but you know, we can help people. We can help them build things. We can do things, by the way, that we don't ordinarily do, but we're good at. We can see things, by the way, that we would rather not. And that's what happens in war, by the way. You see things you would rather not see. How many of us, you know, go out of our way to make sure we're not in a neighborhood where someone could get murdered on the streets or where people are dying or where people are starving? I'll never forget, I was in a nursing home doing a visit, and I walked down, and I was intent on getting to a room, and I walked around this gentleman, and he was in a wheelchair. I walked around him, and I got three steps past him. He said, "That's right, ignore me." Whoa. Stopped me right in my tracks. He said, "You didn't even see me. And yet, you know what? I'm a human being too." Didn't make that mistake again. But he was right. How many people do we walk by and we don't even see them? Or therefore, we can't care about them. We need to be given our time, our resources. We need to be doing things to help other people, even though those other people are difficult. Now, you don't know anybody like that, right? But we need to be helping people who are difficult. And by the way, sometimes we may even be putting ourselves in harm's way. But God won't call you to do any of that unless, A, you're open to the opportunity, and B, you have the capacity to handle it. But let me give you some good news. The good news is God promises to change all this for the better. 5:20. No more shall there be, 65 verse 20. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall all build houses and inhabit them, and they shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build for another to inhabit. They shall not plant for another to eat. For like the days of a tree, shall the days of my people be. And my chosen shall be long, and they will long enjoy the work of their hands, and they shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity. Take a look at what happens in many of the African countries or in Colombia. Moms send their kids out to the street. We worry about sending our kids out to the street. They send their kids out to the street, and they're likely to not come back, end up with a bullet in them, or in the Middle East. But Jesus says that, or God says, that shall not happen. The offspring will be blessed, their descendants as well. See, the good news is God knows what we need. That's what that scripture says. It says, God says, I know what you need. You don't even have to say it. You can start to say it, and that'll be enough for me. I understand, I know, and I will anticipate what you need, because the 65 verse 24, before they call, I will answer. And while they're speaking, I will hear. I guess if I take all that and put it simply, God's going to hit the reset button. God's going to put it back the way it's supposed to be. Question is, are you ready? You want to be part of the reset here and now? And by the way, if you want to do it right now, you want to get closer to that reset, pretty simple. Follow the great commandment. You'll be a lot closer. Amen. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like an ox, but the serpent its food shall be dust. But they shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Not a bad thought, not a bad image. Are you willing to serve? Are you willing to be part of making that happen? Let us come to God in prayer. Almighty and merciful God, give us strength and courage, insight, whatever it takes, so we get it, so that we're willing to serve, that we can move this world closer to the world you intended it to be, so that the transition from this life to life with you is not all that dramatic. We know how it works because we follow the new rules. And so, Lord, help us. Be with us. Grant us strength. Grant us courage. Help us to reach out. Help us to recognize needs. and help us to be good and faithful children to you. All these things we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last till the end of time. What the world needs now is the there's just show me the love. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for a son, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another man. There are cornfields and wheat fields enough to grow.
The world.